In this screencast, we will take information about a process and put it together in order to determine the ultimate gain and ultimate period of a process. For this example, we'll be looking at a temperature control loop, which will be controlling a temperature via the use of cooling water. We're given some information about the transfer function and a time constant for the process transfer function. Additionally, we're given some information about the sensor transmitter and the control valve. To find the ultimate gain and period requires the use of the direct substitution method. Recall that the direct substitution method is a method to indicate the stability of a process, and the ultimate gain, ultimate period represent the edges of that stability between a stable process and an unstable process. So in order to use the direct substitution method, we need to know the characteristic equation. The characteristic equation is 1 plus all the parts of the open loop gain, which will include the process, the valve, the controller, and the transmitter. So what we'll now do is kind of go through each of these to evaluate them. So our process is given that we have a transmitter gain of negative 5 in degrees Celsius per liter per second and a time constant of 10. We'll get to the valve in just a second. The controller we use is, recall that when we analyze using direct substitution for the ultimate gain, we always assume a P-only controller. So therefore, here this will be KC, and we're looking for a gain in percent controller output per percent transmitter output. The transmitter has a time constant of 3 seconds, so therefore this will be 3S plus 1 in the denominator. And we know the fact that the range goes from 20 degrees to 100 degrees Celsius. So if we think about this for a second, we know that the transmitter takes in the value of whatever you're trying to measure and spits out a signal. So therefore, if I want to find the gain here, what's coming out is the signal and percent transmitter output, and what's coming in is the temperature, in this case in degrees Celsius. So we know the range of the temperature is 100 to 20. But we also know that from transmitter output, the lowest temperature will always represent 0% transmitter output, and the highest value represents 100% transmitter output. So this will represent 100 over 80, or 1.25 over 3S plus 1. Now we'll analyze the valve. So the valve is a little trickier because we have a couple pieces of information here. We have that it's linear, and the fact that the max flow is 2 liters per second. And we also know that the time constant for the valve is 5 seconds. So again, the denominator is quite easy. It's again another first order transfer function, 5s plus 1. But now the question is, what is this gain? So the gain is dependent on a few things. One is if it's failed open or fails closed. Two, if it's linear equal percentage. And three, if the pressure drop is constant or not. We know that the valve is linear. We're going to assume in this analysis that delta P is a constant. If it's not, we would use a slightly different equation. The final part we have to figure out here is if it's fail open or fail closed. So in the case of a safety issue, we would definitely want cold water flowing through the process, particularly in the heat exchanger, where it becomes in contact with a hot process fluid. So therefore, we're going to want this valve to fail open. The importance of the fact that we're saying that it fails open is that it dictates by convention that the sign is negative. So before we have a linear valve with a constant pressure drop, what that tells us is that the magnitude of the gain is simply the max flow rate over 100. It's 100 because, again, controller output here ranges from 0% to 100%. If we think about a valve, its input would be controller output, and its output would be the flow rate. So here, we'll have 2 over 100, or 0.02. So with this information, we can fill out a characteristic equation. We now find our least common denominator, which will be the three terms in the denominator of the second term, 10s plus 1, 5s plus 1, times 3s plus 1. We multiply negative 5 by negative 0.02 by 1.25 in Kc to get 0.125 Kc. We can eliminate the denominator now, and what we now have to do is factor out the first term. If we multiply the rest out, what we now do is let S equal I omega to evaluate this using direct substitution. We can take advantage of the fact that I squared equals negative 1. We can now separate this into the real and the imaginary parts. since the whole term is zero, that means the real part and the imaginary part must be zero. So if we look at our two equations, the real equation has two variables, omega and kc. Imaginary has just one, omega, so we'll start there. The i's cancel, one of the omegas canceled. That would be an omega of zero, which is immaterial in this analysis. So what we're left with here is that omega squared equals 18 over 150, or that omega is the square root of 18 over 150, which is approximately 0.346. Going back to the real equation, we can substitute in that value of omega squared, kc, equals 83.2. And this is the assessment of our ultimate gain. In order to find the ultimate period, we take our ultimate frequency and use that, which we just found is 0.346, and that goes in the denominator as the ultimate period is 2 pi over omega. And when we do this, we will have the fact that the ultimate period is 18.15 seconds. As a note, the units for the ultimate gain will be percent control output per percent transmitter output. So in this screencast, we have shown how we can take the information from a process and determine stability information from that process.